The IMF's economic counselor has named it the Great Lockdown, estimating the cumulative loss to global GDP over 2020 and 21 at around $9 trillion, which is greater than the economies of Japan and Germany combined. Within this downturn, the projections are replete with even sharper declines in output in various countries. India is among the handful of countries that is projected to cling on somewhat tenuously to positive growth at 1.9%. In fact, this is the highest growth rate among the G20 economies as estimated by the IMF. Crude oil prices remain in a state of flux despite the agreement on production cuts by OPEC plus countries. India is expected to post a sharp turnaround and resume its pre-COVID, pre-slowdown trajectory by growing at 7.4% in 2021-22. In other production sectors, the situation is more somber. On April 9, the index of industrial production for February was released, showing that industrial output accelerated to its highest rate in 7 months. The impact of COVID-19 is not yet captured in these prints. So therefore, there is no reason to get misled by the IIP data which was released up to February, because the impact of COVID-19 comes thereafter. More tellingly, however, the revival in electricity generation, a coincident indicator of demand that has commenced from January 2020, has been halted by a sharp fall in daily demand in the range of 25% to 30% after the lockdown announcement on March 25th. Automobile production and sales, port freight traffic declined sharply in March, as recently released data indicates. The Manufacturing Purchasing Managers Index, that is PMI for March 2020, which was released on April 2, was the lowest in last 4 months. Notably, suppliers' delivery time lengthened for the first time in 5 months, indicating supply disruptions. The April 6 release showed that services PMI declined into contraction in March 2020, pulled down by a sharp downturn in export business, new domestic orders and employment. In the external sector, the contraction in exports in March 2020 at -34.6% has turned out to be much more severe than during the global financial crisis. However, amidst all this, the level of foreign exchange reserves which we have continue to be robust at US$476.5 billion on April 10th, equivalent to 11.8 months of imports. Turning to the status of banking operations since the nationwide lockdown was imposed by the Government of India, the RBI has taken a number of steps to ensure normal business functioning by the entire banking sector. As a result, payment infrastructure is running seamlessly. Banks have been required to put in place business continuity plans to operate from their disaster recovery sites and or to identify alternate locations for critical operations so that there is no disruption in customer services. Our data show that there was no downtime of internet or mobile banking. On an average, ATM operations stood at 91% of the full capacity. The average availability of business correspondents is over 80%. Regional offices of RBI have supplied fresh currency of ₹1,20,000 crores from March 1 till April 14th to currency chests across the country to meet increased demand for currency in the wake of COVID-19 pandemic. Banks have indeed risen to the occasion by refilling the ATMs regularly despite several logistical challenges. In my statement of March 27, I had indicated that together with the measures announced on March 27, the RBI's liquidity injection was about 3.2% of GDP since February 2020 MPC meeting. And as you would recall, the February MPC meeting, the announcements were made, if I recall correctly, on 6th of February. So from 6th February 2020 till the, till March 27th, including the announcement made on March 27th, RBI had injected injected liquidity of an amount equivalent to 3.2% of our GDP. Since then, that is since March 27th, surplus liquidity in the banking system has increased sharply in the wake of sustained government spending. Systemic liquidity surplus as reflected in net absorptions. I am talking about net absorptions, that is the difference between the taking into account both the reverse repo and the repo. So therefore, the systemic liquidity surplus as reflected in net absorptions under the LAF averaged at about rupees 4.36 lakh crore during the period March 27th to April 14, 2020. As announced on March 27, the RBI undertook three auctions of targeted term repo operations, that is TLTRO, injecting cumulatively rupees 75,041 crore to ease liquidity constraints in the banking system and distress financial markets. Another TLTRO auction of rupees 25,000 crore is being conducted today. In response to these auctions, financial conditions, now this is very important, in response to these conditions, financial conditions have eased. I correct myself, in response to these auctions, financial conditions have eased considerably as reflected in the spreads on money and bond market instruments. Moreover, activity in the corporate bond market has picked up appreciably with several corporates making new issuances. There are also some indications that redemption pressures faced by the mutual funds have also somewhat moderated. Against this background, and as I mentioned that we have been constantly monitoring the situation after considerable internal deliberation and after, you know, monitoring the evolving situation, and in our effort to see that the financial system is fully functional, the markets are fully functional, we have in RBI decided to announce certain additional measures, and I would now like to elaborate upon them. Against this backdrop and based on our continuing assessment of the macroeconomic situation and financial market conditions, we propose to take further measures with the following objectives. One, to maintain adequate liquidity in the system and its constituents in the face of COVID-19 related dislocations. Two, facilitate and incentivize bank credit flows. Three, ease the financial stress. And four, enable the formal functioning of markets. The first set of measures relate to liquidity management. The RBI has moved in a calibrated fashion to ensure conducive financial conditions and normalcy in the functioning of financial markets and institutions. The initial efforts to provide adequate system level liquidity are reflected in sizable net absorptions under the reverse repo operations. With this achieved, the RBI has undertaken measures to target liquidity provision to sectors and entities which are experiencing liquidity constraints and or hindrances to market access. That is, they have a difficulty in accessing the market and they have difficulty of having adequate liquidity with them. LTROs, that is long term repo operations, which we have undertaken. So these were meant to ensure adequate liquidity at longer end of the curve. Longer end of the yield curve. Exemptions from the cash reserve ratio for equivalent incremental credit disbursed by banks as loans in certain select areas and targeted LTROs or TLTROs fall in this category. In this category or in this class and sector specific measures. It is observed that deployment of TLTRO funds so far has largely been to bonds issued by public sector entities and large corporates, especially in primary issuances. The disruptions caused by COVID-19 have, however, more severely impacted small and mid-sized corporates, including NBFCs and MFIs, in terms of their access to liquidity. So we have therefore decided to undertake what we call TLTRO operations 2, that is TLTRO 2.0. Accordingly, it has been decided to conduct targeted long-term repo operations TLTRO 2.0 for an aggregate amount of rupees 50,000 crore to begin with. Please mark my words, rupees 50,000 crore to begin with in tranches of appropriate sizes. Based on our assessment of the evolving situation and based on the pattern of utilization of this 50,000 crore by the market and in the market, it is always open for RBI to step up this amount beyond 50,000 crores as per requirement or as may be necessary to see that various segments of the market, various segments of the, you know, the MFIs, the NBFCs and other institutions in terms of liquidity, they remain well lubricated. The funds availed by the banks under TLTRO 2.0 should be invested in investment grade bonds, commercial paper and non-convertible debentures of NBFCs, with at least 50% of the total amount availed going to small and mid-sized NBFCs and MFIs. So therefore, the emphasis will be to see that there is adequate flow to the mid-size and the small NBFCs as well as to the MFIs. The guidelines in this regard will spell out the relevant details. These investments have to be made within 1 month of the availment of liquidity from RBI, as in the case of the earlier TLTRO auctions which have been conducted so far. Investments made by banks under this facility will be classified as held to maturity HTM even in excess of 25% of total investment permitted to be included in HTM portfolio. Exposures under this facility are also not to be reckoned under the large exposure framework. And the notification for TLTRO 2.0 auction will be issued today.